Jean-Benet Ramsey. This is America's ongoing murder mystery, but this is a mystery to which I wouldn't venture to offer you any hypothetical solution. I can only put before you what happened, recount the clues, invite you to turn detective on a case which has had the armchair Sherlocks tapping away their theories into the internet for several years, which burst into renewed prominence at the start of the new century as the long-running prime suspects scandalized their detractors by appearing in television documentaries and interviews and by writing their account of things in return for an alleged $750,000 publisher's advance. And this story is terribly, terribly sad. On Christmas Day 1996, the Ramseys of Boulder, Colorado, enjoyed the sort of happy family holiday that North American prosperity makes easily available to successful businessmen. John Ramsey, in his 50s, was the multimillionaire president of Access Graphics, a Lockheed subsidiary company distributing computers, which he had founded. Patsy, his second wife, is a former beauty queen. She and her sister both won the title Miss West Virginia. The Ramseys had two children, Burke, who was 9, and his little sister Jean-Benet, 6. The odd name seems to be a Frenchified feminization of John's given names, John Bennett. Patsy, understandably, called her daughter Johnny B. Boulder, Colorado is a small township 25 miles northwest of Denver and home to the University of Colorado. With a predominantly academic population keeping the electorate liberal, it has made itself something of a little green paradise where rich and successful businessmen like John Ramsey are happy to live without the pressures of urban criminality and drugs. Obviously, this is especially true for family men concerned about their children. The Ramseys socialized largely with other prosperous early middle-aged upper middle-class couples who had smallish children. Closest to John Ramsey was Fleet White, a retired oil executive in his late 40s, with a son and daughter about Jean-Benet's age. Then there were John and Barbara Fernie. There was Glenn Stein, the University of Colorado's finance manager, with a son of about Burke's age. There were the Walkers. And some of the Ramseys' professional advisors or associates were personal friends too, like Michael Bynum, the lawyer, Rod Westmoreland, the stockbroker, or Roll Hoverstock, the priest at St. John's Episcopalian Church, where they worshipped. The Christmas season saw a lot of familial socialising among these people. On the 23rd, the Ramseys threw their Christmas party with gingerbread houses for all the children to decorate with gumdrops. As it happened for the past 3 years, Bill McReynolds, a retired professor of journalism from the university, came as Santa Claus and read out little personalised doggerel verses Patsy had composed for each of the children in turn. Patsy had been delighted by Bill's natural white beard when she saw him working as a street Santa, and she invited him to come and be the Ramseys' Santa every year after that. Jean-Benet got to know him at these annual occasions, called him Uncle Sam, and in 1965 took him on a tour of the entire house from the bedrooms to the basement. Professor McReynolds was a little frail following heart bypass surgery in 1966, and Mrs. McReynolds accompanied him to the party. The following day, Christmas Eve, the Ramsey family had their evening meal out at a restaurant and then drove around Boulder looking at the Christmas lights before taking the children home to bed. It's not the commercial Regent Street sort of lights that delight decent homespun American family folk, but the candles people put in the windows of their homes. Once the kids were safely tucked up and asleep, John Ramsey nipped out to a neighbour's and collected the bicycle Jean-Benet was getting as her Christmas present to go under the tree in the living room. I specify the living room because the Ramseys were so extraordinarily Christmas celebration-oriented that they had decorated artificial trees in every room they habitually used, including all their bedrooms. And wanting a change from the traditional red, gold and white, Patsy had decorated them in a purple colour scheme. They also opened their decorated house to the public on one day, a local scheme akin to our open garden days in the summer, and perhaps a little tacky and nouveau riche-ish to British tastes. Christmas morning was a happy time. The family exchanged presents, and early in the afternoon Jean-Benet took her new bicycle out and rode it on the patio. She could be trusted outside on her own, A neighbour was used to seeing her roller skating unsupervised up to her fence, then turning and going back to her home frontage from exactly the point her parents had told her she mustn't pass. I don't myself share the primary school teachers of Boulder's rather gushy passion for good little girls, but noting that JonBenet had won a class medal in an "I saw you doing something good" contest, one must take it that she was pretty unlikely to get up to mischief, like creeping out of bed to raid the refrigerator at night without permission, which may be important. The evening meal on Christmas Day was round at the Whites, and after dinner the Ramsays drove to two other family friends' houses delivering gifts before getting home at about 10 p.m, putting the sleeping JonBenet straight to bed in her underwear without bothering to put on a nightie, and then settling down themselves. Boxing Day isn't Boxing Day in the United States. People don't give Christmas boxes to the dustmen and postmen. Instead, they go to stores which definitely do not declare a bank holiday, but remain open to accept back unwanted gifts that people want to exchange. The Ramsays, however, were not going to trail over to Toys R Us or Sears. The 26th of December was to be a travelling day for them. They were going to Charlevoix in the late dotted north of Michigan, where John's father had bought a country retreat years before. There they were to spend the new year with John's young adult son and daughter by his first marriage, John Andrew and Melinda. The Ramsay family were to leave at 6:30 a.m. and fly to Michigan in John's private company plane. And so John and Patsy were up early, he first going into the bathroom to shower and shave. Patsy, as she always did first thing in the morning, came down the back stairs from the second floor, which was entirely taken up with the master bedroom and its two bathrooms and ensuite dressing areas. The stairs led her to a landing with two doors opening off it. To the left in front of her, JonBenet's room. Facing her, the room kept for Melinda in this northwest section of the house, which was the daughter's area of the two ensuite bedrooms, though JonBenet, like Burke, was always bathed upstairs in her mother's bathroom. Behind and to her left lay the children's playroom, passing through which would bring one to the more capacious front staircase, opposite which lay John Andrew's room, and beyond that Burke's. Commendable housewifeliness brought Patsy down to the first floor back landing at 5:30 in the morning. In its corner, opposite JonBenet's room, was a washer-dryer and a sink in which Mrs. Ramsay rinsed out any clothes JonBenet had soiled, the child being an habitual bedwetter and frequently incontinent during the day. This 26th of December, Patsy had one of the little girl's jumpsuits to rinse through, having done which she started down a spiral staircase leading to the back of the hall on the ground floor. On the stairs she saw three pieces of paper, lined notepaper from a memo pad. They were neatly written over, and the writing proved to be one of the most remarkable kidnapper's ransom notes ever seen. Listen carefully for the clues and oddities in this strange missive. "Mr. Ramsay," it opened. "Listen carefully. We are a group of individuals that represent a small foreign faction. We respect your business," and that word is misspelt with two S's between the U and the I, "but not the country that it serves. At this time we have your daughter in our possession. She is safe and unharmed, and if you want her to see 1997, you must follow our instructions to the letter. You will draw $118,000 from your account. $100,000 will be in $100 bills, and the remaining $18,000 in $20 bills. Make sure that you bring an adequate size attaché to the bank. When you get home, you will put the money in a brown paper bag. I will call you between 8 and 10 tomorrow to instruct you on delivery. The delivery will be exhausting, so I advise you to be rested. If we monitor you getting the money early, we might call you early to arrange an earlier delivery of the money, and hence earlier delivery crossed out, pickup of your daughter. Any deviation of my instructions will result in the immediate execution of your daughter. You will also be denied her remains for proper burial. The two gentlemen watching over your daughter do not particularly like you, so I advise you not to provoke them. Speaking to anyone about your situation, such as police, FBI, etc., will result in your daughter being beheaded. If we catch you talking to a stray dog, she dies. If you alert the bank authorities, she dies. If the money is in any way marked or tampered with, she dies. You will be scanned for electronic devices, and if any are found, she dies. You can try to deceive us, but be warned that we are familiar with law enforcement countermeasures and tactics. You stand a 99% chance of killing your daughter if you try to outsmart us. Follow our instructions and you stand a 100% chance of getting her back. You and your family are under constant scrutiny as well as the authorities. Don't try to grow a brain, John. You are not the only fat cat around, so don't think that killing will be difficulty. Don't underestimate us, John. Use that good southern common sense of yours. It's up to you now, John. Victory. S.B.T.C. Now, this letter is both extraordinary and important. Important because writing from the perpetrator offers absolutely the best basis for offender profiling. Extraordinary, as the first detectives to look at it realized, because of its length. It has been called the War and Peace of ransom notes. All such notes usually say is, we've got your kid, it'll cost you X thousand pounds, wait for our instructions and don't go near the police. There are other features making this the major clue for our attention, and we'll come back to some of them later. On reading the first few lines, Patsy Ramsey rushed into John Benet's room and screamed on finding her bed empty. John came out to see what was the matter and, by his later account, screamed too, and told Patsy to get on the telephone and dial 911, the American equivalent of 999, while he read through the note. Patsy's call to the police was automatically recorded, and at the end of the call, with Patsy bawling hysterical prayers into the telephone, enhancement of overtly inaudible background sound reveals Burke asking, "What did you find?" and his father answering, "We weren't speaking to you." This, too, came to have a little significance later. By the end of the morning, the house was surrounded by squad cars. The first officer at the scene made a quick check through the house, omitting to open a door at the end of the slightly labyrinthine basement. This would become matter for extreme regret. John Ramsey called his bank in Atlanta and started arrangements to have the $118,000 moved to a Boulder account. He called his hired pilot to change his flight arrangements, but was too late, as the pilot was already in the air. He called his friends, and Fleet's White's wife took Burke to her home for the day, while Fleet stayed with the Ramseys, as did John and Barbara Fernie. Fleet White made another check of the house, including just opening the door to the wine cellar that the police had not touched at the end of the basement. He found nothing. At 1 o'clock, John Ramsey and Fleet White made yet another check. This time, John went first to the wine cellar door, opened it, and screamed. Inside the room, but not clearly visible until one took a step into it, lay the body of Jean Benet. It was dressed in a short T-shirt, incontinence pants, and underpants embroidered Wednesday, covered with a white blanket. Next to it lay a nightie with a Barbie doll motif. A strip of black duct tape sealed the child's mouth. A white nylon cord had been tightened around her neck with a slip knot. About 18 inches of it dangled with a small piece of splintered wood tied to its end. Another piece of white cord was tied around her right wrist. John Ramsey picked up his daughter, who was rigid with rigor mortis, and carried her upstairs, where he put her on the floor and tried hopeless resuscitation. Patsy threw herself on the body, crying and embracing her dead daughter. The kidnapping had changed to a murder hunt in a moment. And now I'm going to bring together a lot of evidence that was actually acquired piecemeal over the next 2 months. Jean Benet had suffered 2 serious injuries, either of which would have proved lethal. Hidden under her long blonde hair was an 11-inch fracture to her skull, which had detached a small triangular fragment at one end. The noose round her neck had caused petechial hemorrhaging, the small blood spots under the skin indicating lethal strangulation. This led the pathologists to conclude that the injury to the head had happened first, and then, before it could end Jean Benet's life, the killer strangled her. There were also injuries in and around her private parts. Her panties were blood-stained and her hymen was ruptured. The pathologists agreed that these had been caused at the time of her death, though a minority of experts thought she might also have been sexually interfered with earlier. A microscopic trace of foreign cellulose material in the vagina seemed likely to have come from the splintered wood attached to the cord round her neck. Black fibres around the groin area indicated that some fabric had been used to wipe her clean. There were no traces of semen, although a smear on the thigh, which later proved to be some soapy cleanser, was at first thought to show that she had been the victim of a male sexual molester. Green fragments in her hair indicated that it had brushed against the Christmas garlands decorating both staircases. There were no conclusive signs of anyone breaking into the house. A window in a basement room where Burke kept his toy trains had been broken by John some time previously when he accidentally locked himself out. But he believed that glass fragments on a suitcase lying beneath it suggested more recent entry there. A palm print on the door of the wine cellar has never been identified, nor has a high-tech shoe footprint in the dust beside the body. The Ramseys argue that these things show that an intruder entered and killed their daughter. Police detectives disagree, pointing out that the first detectives on the scene had noted a spider's web across the broken basement window, although spiders can spin new webs very quickly if old ones are broken, and that the palm and footprints might have been left much earlier by still unidentified visitors, like workmen who came to the house for various reasons over the previous months. They add that the first detectives on the scene observed that there were no traces of anyone coming up to the house through the snow that partially surrounded it, but only partially. When a child is murdered on the premises where its parents are present, they are the first people to come under investigation. Detectives remarked that on that first day, Patsy greeted them fully made up and dressed in the clothes she'd worn the previous day, which seemed odd if she'd got up at 5:30 to start the new day of travelling and immediately suffered the trauma of finding the ransom note. One detective also thought that Patsy had acted suspiciously in covering her face while crying, but peeping through her fingers to see how the police were reacting. John struck some observers as remarkably cold and detached, but he was, after all, a mature man, and he had learned resignation after suffering the death in a car accident of his elder daughter by his first marriage, and the belief that Patsy would die of serious ovarian cancer 3 years previously. She miraculously and heroically pulled through with chemotherapy. It did the Ramseys' public image no good that after staying with the Ferries, they arranged to leave for Atlanta within 3 days, taking John Berry's body for burial there. It didn't help either that their friend and lawyer Michael Bynum started advising them to protect their rights as soon as it became clear that they were under investigation, so that they stalled giving the police untrammelled interviews for months, although they hired a spin doctor and got themselves interviewed on CNN television. By the Ramseys' account, the meal at the Whites' on Christmas Day was John Benet's last, but her stomach contained partially undigested remains of pineapple, which the Whites had not served, and a bowl of cut pineapple with Burke's fingerprints on it lay on the kitchen counter. Remember I said that Jean Benet didn't seem likely to be a nocturnal fridge raider? In the teeth of the tape-recorded evidence that Burke was up and asking questions when Patsy made her first 911 call, the Ramseys, including Burke, all insist that he was in his room asleep or pretending to sleep until some hours later. But by far their biggest problems are closer links to the crime scene. Black and red fibres clinging to the duct tape found on Jean Benet's mouth were definitely not from any of their clothes, except possibly the jacket Patsy had been wearing on Christmas Day and again on Boxing Day. The original roll of duct tape and hank of cord had been removed from the house and have never been found, so that their provenance cannot be certainly identified. But in November, Patsy Ramsey definitely made 2 purchases at a hardware store of items whose prices exactly matched those of the tape and cord. Neither she nor the store could say what her purchases actually were. The piece of wood, which had presumably made a handle to tighten the killer's ligature, was the broken handle of one of Patsy's paintbrushes from her painting kit, which was near the wine cellar. The ransom note was definitely written on paper from a notepad of John Ramsey's, using a Ramsey family felt-tip pen that had then been returned to the cup of pens in the kitchen where it was normally kept. The million-dollar residence is big and complicated enough that it surpasses belief that a complete stranger could have broken into the house and had the good luck to find the way down the stairs from Jean Benet's room to the remote wine cellar, picking up John Ramsey's writing pad and the appropriate pen to write a note on the way there or back. And that note! Every detective who saw it thought it was hinky. The small foreign faction was an obvious blind. It doesn't seem to have been noticed that it suggests an author old enough to remember the 1970s when the Symbionese Liberation Army kidnapped Patty Hearst and the Red Brigade and the Tupamaros were going in for politically motivated kidnappings abroad. The sum demanded was very odd. $118,000, not a round number. Was it a coincidence that John Ramsay's Christmas bonus that year was for $18,000? To this day, nobody has been able to explain the signature SBTC, though strained efforts to connect it with John Ramsay's military service training or some Christian reference have been attempted. It's a fake kidnap note, evidently left to mislead in some way, and this has suggested that the duct tape gag and potential bondage cord on John Benet's wrist may likewise be false clues. Handwriting comparison suggests that the note could not have been written by John Ramsay or any other plausible suspect, except, well, it might have been written by Patsy. Fleet White rather soon quarrelled with John Ramsay and does not believe that John supported the investigation as he should have done. The press pounced on quarrels and confusions in Boulder law enforcement. The police detective department was at odds with the district attorney's office. The detectives thought the Ramsays were guilty, one of them, they didn't know which, having killed John Benet, the other covering for his or her spouse. The DA's office still thought an intruder might have done it, as the Ramsays still claim. The police chief was a close friend of the DA's and ordered kid-glove treatment of these important citizens at the start of the case. Eventually, the head of detectives, the chief of police, and several detectives resigned or had their careers blighted. The DA hung on to his post by the skin of his teeth. After a couple of years, the case went before a grand jury, which was unable to find a true bill of indictment against anyone, and the case is still rattling on, drawing an ever higher national profile. After the O.J. Simpson fiasco, John Public is ready to believe that multimillionaires can easily buy themselves into getting away with murder, although nobody has ever been able to suggest a plausible motive for either Ramsay to kill John Benet. The sexual interference led to the horrible suggestion that she was victim of parental incest, but exhaustive searches have established that John Ramsay's closest brush with impropriety was one single visit to a dirty bookshop, and there isn't a hint of kiddie porn or incest in his life. Patsy wins few friends by her role-player's habit of flipping from flirtatiousness to calculating manipulativeness and sometimes a very hard-nosed aggression, but southern belles of her generation often show such mercurial changes which are in no way associated with murderous tendencies. It seems ridiculous to suggest that she lost her temper with John Benet over the child's incontinence and struck her a death blow. The reason the case attracted such national attention was not the all-too-human muddles in the investigation, however. It was John Benet's standing as Little Miss Colorado 1995. Patsy Ramsay and her mother and her sister were all obsessed with the beauty contests, which had been their one claim to fame. And they entered John Benet in the perfectly horrid Moppets pageants, which dress little girls up in inappropriately fetching costumes and adult makeup, and set them to sing and dance inappropriately adult songs, and award them crowns and tiaras and sashes like their big sisters who hope to reach the Miss World or Miss Universe titles. When Jean Benet wasn't an instant winner, Patsy went to other enthusiasts to get coaching for her, and this resulted in her developing a dance routine so coyly suggestive that the little girl's original dance teacher was disgusted. Patsy also employed a photographer whose reputation lay in his ability to make prepubescent girls look like nubile 20-year-olds. Most Americans find this entire business odiously tacky and strongly suggestive of softcore kiddie porn. Patsy's chameleon ability to switch roles defensively is never more obvious than when she faces this line of attack. If sweetness and charm don't persuade you that it's all harmless sentimental attachment to dear little daughters, she'll try the educational role, saying that being a beauty queen teaches poise and self-confidence. She urges that she always told John Benet the talent section was the most important. That was real achievement. A curious claim when one looks at the videos of John Benet's absolutely execrable singing. And if that doesn't work, Patsy snaps into aggression, telling her critics to get a life, as though turning one's daughter into an animated Barbie doll and indulging in gut-wrenching competitiveness with equally insensitive mothers represents some sort of desirable self-fulfillment. I can understand the Ramsays' anger at the hypocrisy of tabloid newspapers, which pretend to disapprove of kiddie pageants while actually delighting in the opportunity to print their pictures. Only the Ramsays can't clearly express such anger, as it would mean acknowledging that making such a spectacle of Jean Benet in the first place was, at best, ill-judged and tasteless on their part. Still, America rages on. The internet is full of pages and comments from Rams and anti-Rams. The Ramses, claiming that the grand jury has cleared them, now break their silence, or should one say increase their volume, with suggestions that Fleet White, the traitor friend who left their cause, or Bill McReynolds, the family Santa, who they allege secretly told Jean Benny he would see her again after Christmas, or the sexy child photographer who subsequently suffered a breakdown and was found walking naked through the streets declaring that he hadn't killed Jean Benny, all these, the Ramses say, warrant serious attention. The Ramses' behaviour doesn't always look especially innocent, but John's capacity to seem cool and detached and Patsy's skill at appearing tacky militate against them. We should never forget that the two most experienced investigative interviewers in America, Robert Ressler and John Douglas, who invented offender profiling, have examined the Ramses at some length, and they concur that while the murder must have been an inside job to the extent that the perpetrator knew the house and the family, well, they think the Ramses are innocent. I think the key lies in the weapon that struck Jean Benny's head. The suggested blunt instruments found in the house, a large electric torch on the kitchen counter, or one of John Ramses's golf clubs, can safely be ruled out. The Lockhart exchange principle means that either would have shown microscopic traces of Jean Benny's hair or body tissue, had they been used. But the killer clearly made some effort to get rid of the blunt instrument, along with the original roll of duct tape, the original hank of white cord, and the black fabric item used to wipe John Benny's groin. Find those things, or how they were disposed of, and I think we'd be on the way to solving the mysteries.